this morning we're going to jump into our message now called You Belong Here. And so this is week number two of this series that we started last week. And throughout this series, we're looking at different reasons why it's so important and even not just important, I believe necessary or vital that we gather together as believers in the body of Christ. We're looking at different topics that help us to understand that everyone belongs here as a part of the body of Christ. And I hope that those who come to our church feel as though they belong here into this local family, this local body of Christ as well. Last week, we talked about how we gather to encourage one another. We looked at the topic of encouragement. We gather so we can encourage one another. We gather so that we don't feel as though in life we're walking through challenges alone. And we gather to help and encourage and lead and direct one another as the body of Christ. And in that, there's accountability and everything that comes with gathering together for encouragement. And the best part was we had a wonderful opportunity that evening then to put it into practice. We had a potluck last Sunday night, and we had about 70-some people Sunday morning. We had about 60 people Sunday night that came back for our potluck, and it was an awesome time of fellowship, of playing games, of just talking around the tables. People brought delicious food, and it was just a wonderful time. And so for those of you who came, thank you, and next time we have it, if you weren't able to join us, we would love to have you join us as we just spend time encouraging, spend time gathering together, because I think it's more important now than it's ever been just because of what we have gone through these last couple of years. It's so important people get back into the routine of being out and about and gathering together amongst the body of Christ. So as we get started this morning, I want to ask everyone to think about some of the habits you have. What are some of the habits you have? I'm not asking you to call them out. But what are some of the habits you have? Here's a few of mine that I'll share. I like to brush my teeth every morning and every night. Right? It's a habit. Brushing my teeth in the morning and night. Spending time in prayer and spending time in God's Word daily. Another habit that I have is I often, typically in the morning, I like to check my phone and kind of see what happened the night before in the sports world. That's a habit that I have. I like to kind of look at it and get a recap of maybe what happened the night before in sports, because oftentimes I don't really get to watch it or anything, but I just like to kind of be up to date. So those are just kind of a few, just some of them simple, practical habits, different things. Some of them more important than others. Some of them are, you know, you may look at it and go, ah, that. Checking your phone for sports, that's kind of a silly habit. But again, what are some habits that you have? Just think about that process and think about that this morning. What are some of the habits that you have in your life? Maybe it's daily, it's kind of weekly, it's, you know, whatever. It doesn't necessarily have to be a daily thing, per se, to be a habit that we have. And I know for many of you, and I know myself included, oftentimes we hear this question of what are your habits? Our first ones, we automatically go to thinking, what are the negative habits I have? Right? What are maybe the habits I have that aren't healthy habits or aren't the best habits that I have? But I want to encourage you and remind you that I believe that you have good habits too. Habits doesn't have to be a negative term. It doesn't have to have a negative connotation. Rather, I would encourage and share with you this morning that I believe habits should be something that are positive, something that are an addition in our lives. Habits are more deeply ingrained than you might think. I want to share this little thought with you. Habits are our brain's way of increasing its efficiency. Our brain turns daily actions and behaviors into habits, so we would do them automatically and without too much thought, thus freeing up our brain power for other more important challenges. This strategy of our brain has wonderful benefits for us. It allows us to function better in life. Just imagine if you had to consider and ponder every single task or reaction that you have within a day. You'd be exhausted, right? If you had to consciously, like, think through every single thing you do all day, every reaction you have, if you did that, it would be exhausting. mentally we would be exhausted, but yet there's so many things in our life that we just do because it's just a habit. We don't even think about it. It's almost like we just get in this mode, and all of a sudden, next thing we know, maybe in the morning, we've gone through a whole morning routine in 15, 20 minutes, however long it takes you to go through your morning routine of hygiene or whatever it may be, and all of a sudden you're like, I guess I just brushed my teeth, I took a shower, I brushed my, you know, like we don't even often think about it. We just do it. It's just a part of our day. It's a habit. It's a part of just what we do naturally. So with kind of this little nugget of truth, this nugget of wisdom that I just shared about, you know, how basically it's our brain's way of increasing our efficiency because we're not wasting brain power, basically, making all these tiny decisions that are just become a normal part of our life, a habit in our lives. I want to offer you another little nugget of wisdom. Habits follow cravings as a craving seek rewards. Habits follow cravings, and cravings are seeking rewards. So for instance, if you have a person who wants to stop smoking but they won't address the cravings and the reward contributing to the habit, they're going to have an incredibly difficult time kicking that habit because they're still craving the rewards of what smoking brings to them. So you may say, man, I would love to quit, but I still am seeking that craving, or I'm seeking the reward that I receive from it. It's hard to actually truly kick whatever that habit is that you're dealing with. And you can insert whatever habit into there. Smoking was just the example that I used this morning. Similarly, as we desire to create new habits, hopefully healthy habits in our lives, we also need to address the underlying cravings and the rewards that contribute to those habits. Do you crave healthy, God-honoring relationship with others? Do you earnestly desire a consistent and a powerful prayer life? Are you hungry for a deeper understanding of the Word of God and the teachings that we find within His Word? Think about this for a moment. What would your faith look like if you really craved fellowship, communion, worship, and prayer? If you were craving fellowship, communion, worship, and prayer. We're going to touch on those four topics as we move throughout our time this morning. How could a healthy rhythm of gathering and fellowship with other believers help you to develop the habits of faith that you've been wanting, that maybe you've been craving, you've been desiring for so long? So this morning, why we gather together to help us to find a rhythm, to help us to find, to develop and have healthy habits in our lives. The early church, 2,000 years ago, the apostles, after Christ died and resurrected and goes back into heaven, if you study them, you study the book of Acts, what did they do constantly? They gathered together. They were constantly gathering together in fellowship with other believers to help them to develop healthy habits, to help them to grow in their faith. They understood the importance of gathering together, that churches and communities of faith, and it's been modeled for hundreds of years following the example that the early church leaders set after Jesus. Acts chapter 2, verse 42, we're going to look at this morning. We're going to be in Acts chapter 2 and then move our way into a few other passages this morning. But Acts chapter 2, verse 42, highlights several things that were specifically devoted to doing when we gather together. As I read the passage, listen for what these things might be. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. What did it say? It said teaching, fellowship, breaking of bread, and prayer. They gathered together and they devoted themselves to these four things to help develop healthy habits, to have a healthy rhythm of life that they were walking in. The early church devoted themselves to teaching or learning, right? Because we can hear teaching all day, but if we're not actually processing it, applying it, and living differently, we're not actually learning. We're just kind of sitting, absorbing maybe, but we're not actually learning. It's not changing us. Fellowship, gathering together, breaking of bread, communion, and spending time in prayer. These are the rewards, if you will, of a healthy rhythm, of having healthy habits, of gathering together with other believers. And the early church was devoted to it, and I believe that today we need to get back to focusing on these four things. The word devotion is a powerful word, and I'm going to share its definition. It'll be on the screen behind me this morning. So devotion means to consistently show strength which prevails in spite of difficulties, to endure, to stay in a fixed direction, steadfast. Consistently show strength which prevails in spite of difficulties, to endure, to stay in a fixed direction, or steadfast. The church, the early church was unwavering in their commitment to gathering together for teaching, fellowship, breaking of bread, and being in prayer together. In fact, if we look just a couple verses further down in Acts chapter 2, verse 46, we see the same word used again. The passage says that they continued or persevered daily in meeting together. They continued to daily meet together as the body of Christ. As a comparison, I want you to think about something that you are absolutely committed to doing every day in your life. Right? I think for each of us, there are certain things that we do every single day in our life. I want you to think about some of those things. Again, those habits that we have. Something that's become so deeply ingrained in who you are that it's just a part of you. Again, you don't even think about it. It just happens. You just do it without even really realizing it or thinking about it. The thing you're thinking about. This is a kind of unwavering devotion that the early church had. A consistent rhythm in their lives. It's that kind of habit that I desire for us to have today in 2022. That we would have a devotion to teaching, to gathering together, to prayer, to spending time in communion with one another and with God our Father. It's going to require us, though, to learn things a little bit differently than maybe we have before. So what are the rewards we gain from a habit, or good habits, or these habits if we begin to teach in fellowship, breaking of bread, and be in prayer? So number one, I want to touch on this topic of teaching or learning. How many of you enjoy learning? By show of hands. And if you don't, that's okay. I understand. It's not everybody's thing. I think we all need to continue to strive to learn each and every day. But some people, they really enjoy that. They like the world of academia and different things like that. And not everybody does. The reward of good teaching is learning. And learning the scriptures together with other believers was something the early church was devoted to doing. They were devoted to learning the scriptures, to walking through scriptures, to discussing scripture amongst one another. They were always trying to teach and learn and obviously allow the Holy Spirit to help them to understand it, but also to help one another to understand, to see scripture, maybe in a different perspective than they're able to see it. But learning takes time. It can be difficult. Learning requires your attention and your effort. The reward, however, is a deeper understanding and knowledge of God, of His Word, of what He's wanting us to do in our lives. And I'm not sure I know any follower of Christ who would say that they don't want a deeper understanding of Scripture. They don't want a deeper walk with the Lord. That they ultimately aren't striving to be more like Christ in their lives. Right? I believe that every believer I believe desires those things, longs for those things, wants those things in their life. So what do? How do we get there? We have to have our time, our energy, our attention needs to be spent teaching and learning and spending time in fellowship with one another and with God. So what are a few ways to do that? We have some opportunities here at our church on a weekly basis to help you continue to grow and to learn, to continue to dig deeper in God's Word, to gather for fellowship amongst one another. Wednesday nights, we have our adult Bible studies at 6:45. Sunday mornings at 9:15, we gather for our adult Bible study before service. We just wrapped up a study on Psalm 23 on Wednesday nights. Right now, we're currently going through the gifts of the Spirit in our Sunday morning Bible study time. So those are great opportunities for as adults for you to have a chance to come alongside, to be a part of a group, to teach, to learn, to grow in understanding of God's Word, to grow in your faith, to find community within our church. For our men, we have our Bible study on Thursday mornings at 8 o'clock where we're walking through the Bible from cover to cover. There's opportunities to continue learning and to continue growing in your faith. So number one, we looked at this idea of teaching, learning, a habit, of being in a habit of teaching, being in a habit of learning. Number two, I believe we need to develop the habit of being in fellowship or gathering together. Being in fellowship, gathering together. And this kind of, some of this fits in a little bit with what we talked about last week with we gather for encouragement. But as I mentioned earlier, in Acts chapter 2, verse 46, the early church was devoted and steadfast in meeting together daily. Meeting together daily. Now, I'm not going to say that we need to meet together daily in a formal service like this, right? That every day at 10:15, I expect you to be here. Right? That's not what I'm saying as I talk about this example that was set by the early church. But I would encourage everyone to think about getting regular time and fellowship with other believers throughout the week outside of our Sunday morning gatherings. There's only so much fellowship. There's only so much community building. There's only so much rubbing shoulders we can have with one another within our gathering on Sunday mornings. But I believe that throughout the week, Wednesdays, Thursday mornings for our men, different events we have going on throughout the year at different times. Or how about this? Just call someone and go out to coffee together. Right? Just fellowshipping amongst one another, joining together, gathering together, encouraging one another. Again, some of the things that we offer here at the church, I already mentioned some of the Bible studies we do for adults. Wednesday nights, we also have our Elevate Youth for our middle school and high schoolers. We have our elementary Rangers and Girls Ministry programs for our kids, as well as our Sunday morning kids ministries that we offer. And then different things throughout the year. For example, in 2 weeks, we have our Mother-Daughter Spa Day. That's a great time to gather together for fellowship. It's a great time to gather together with other women in the body of Christ and build relationships and grow alongside one another. So those are just different examples of things we have done to try to have fellowship. And again, last Sunday night at potluck, a great time of fellowship. So we look at the habit of being teachable or learning, taking the effort and attention to continue learning. Second, fellowship, the importance of gathering together. Number three, the breaking of bread or communion. Communion is incredibly important. We observe communion on a monthly basis or close to a monthly basis here as a church. Here's why the early church was stubbornly devoted to breaking bread together. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting verse 23, we read, "The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'The cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and you drink this cup, You proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. What is communion about? It's about remembering Jesus. It's about remembering the covenant that he made through his blood and his flesh being beaten, broken, poured out, bruised, going upon a cross, and resurrecting from the dead. It's important that we remember and we honor communion. It represents Jesus, his life, the sacrifice he took upon the cross. As I said, his body being broken for us. His blood, which is the marker of a new life, of a new covenant between God and man. His death, his resurrection, and as it says at the end of that verse, also the promise that he will return. The promise that he will return and he will gather his church together once again. These are realities for believers that we simply cannot forget. And because communion is done with others, it's done within the fellowship of other believers. It flows out of our celebration of who Jesus was and remembering what Jesus has done. And we do so together corporately. Think about it like this. Our common union, the thing that believers together all around the world for the past 2,000 years have celebrated is what? Jesus Christ. The one common thing that believers throughout the whole world for the last 2,000 years have celebrated is Jesus Christ. And communion is our opportunity to continue to remember him together on a regular basis in a corporate gathering together. What an amazing gift we have in Jesus. Through Jesus, we find eternal life. Our salvation has come through his blood. So teaching, learning, fellowship, gathering together, breaking of bread, communion, these are all things that develop a healthy rhythm in our lives as they become a habit, as they become something that by nature we just end up doing without even really actually always having to consciously make the decision at certain times to do. And finally, number four, prayer. Simply put, prayer is an exchange where we're in conversation with God. We're talking with him. We're sharing our concerns. Maybe we're saying thanks and we're praising God for what he's done. And we're in dialogue with him. We're talking with our Heavenly Father. Right? We could spend weeks and weeks and months and the rest of the year focusing solely on the topic of prayer. It's a gift to pray with others in community. It's a gift to have corporate prayer. It's a gift to gather together and pray alongside one another, to pray for one another, to pray in unison about something as a body. There's power when we pray together, when we make our requests known to one another. In fact, when asked for advice on prayer, Jesus gave a pretty good answer about how we're supposed to pray. Chapter 6, verse 9. It says this is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Right? I know that as I look around the room, I know that many of you are familiar with the Lord's Prayer. In fact, many of you probably have it memorized, maybe since the time you were quite young. But how many of you have ever thought about the communal nature of this prayer? About as a group praying this prayer. Did you notice that Jesus doesn't instruct us to pray using personal pronouns like my and me? What does he use? He says our and us. Not my and me, our and us, Jesus says in this prayer. Right? The most famous prayer of all time, the most known prayer of all time is a communal one. It's meant to be prayed for and over a group of people. If not meant to be spoken loud in the midst of fellowship with others, it's certainly meant to be spoken with fellowship and community in mind. There is power when we pray with one another, and we are committed to praying with one another when we come together. I want to ask you, would you join me this morning in saying the Lord's Prayer together? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Hallelujah. As we wrap up our time together this morning, I want to revisit something that I said last week. You may remember last week we focused on Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 and 25. And in verse 25, it talks about how some people have developed a habit of not meeting together anymore. It said, let us not give up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing. So what does he say? Some have gotten out of the habit of meeting together. Let us not do that. It's important that we are in fellowship with one another, meeting together. Why do we meet together for encouragement? Why is it so important that we have fellowship with one another? It's more than just the fellowship. We gather together because as the body of Christ, it's who we are called to be. We are called to be the body of Christ. We are called to be together. We are called that when adversity comes to someone's doorstep, we are standing there with them as they face adversity, as they walk through it. We are called that when things don't go our way, that we can lean on our brothers and sisters in Christ and we can help one another, we can encourage one another, we can pick each other up when things are difficult. We are called to be together because when we're confused, when we're frustrated, when we're angry, when maybe we don't know what to do, we have Scripture, we have God's Word, we have the Holy Spirit, and that's the ultimate authority. But many times God may choose to work through somebody else to speak encouragement, to speak discernment, to speak wisdom, to bring clarity into whatever situation you find yourself in. We join together. We spur each other on towards love and the work that God is calling us to do, as it tells us in Hebrews chapter 10. While that is true, it's also true that there are numerous and wonderful benefits we experience when we come together. We learn. We remember. We fellowship. And we pray for one another. And those are just a few of the reasons why it's so important that we meet together, that we belong into a body of Christ. The early church was absolutely committed to these practices. And I believe today that they knew a thing or two about these habits and the necessity of them because it helped them persevere what they were going through. And I believe it can help you and I persevere what we are going through today in our lives. If I could have Joy and Larry and Carl come back up at this time. So this is my challenge for us this week. I want you to identify some of your habits or the rhythms that you have in your life, as I started with that question this morning. What are your habits? What are maybe some of the rhythms of your life that you have? Identify those things. Because if we can't identify them, if we don't know what it is, it's hard for us to work on them. So maybe a couple ways to identify them. What are things that you do every morning? Right? Or maybe it's every Monday you do this, every Tuesday you do this, every Wednesday you kind of got a structured schedule, a rhythm of how you go about your day. What is positive about them? What would you like to maybe change about some of the rhythms or the habits that you have in your life? And if you're not in the rhythm of gathering together with other believers on a regular basis, can I ask you to consider why this week? Can I ask you to consider why this week? Are there things keeping you from fellowship? Are there things keeping you from gathering together in the body of Christ? Maybe it's past hurts. Maybe it's fears. Maybe there's other things that are robbing you of the rich rewards of a life lived in fellowship with others. This morning, we're going to close out our time together by joining corporately in prayer through a time of worship. The worship team is going to lead us through the song, The Blessing, which we've sung here before as a church. But it's based off of the prayer from Numbers chapter 6. It says, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. So this morning, we're going to close out our time in prayer. Through worship. Through worshiping, through singing prayer. If you'd like prayer this morning, I'll be off to the side. Maybe you need to come up here to the altar this morning. I want us to close out our time this morning in prayer. And again, part of the reason we gather together is to pray for one another. So if maybe someone is in need of prayer, like I said, I'll be over there, but maybe you're sensing God nudging you to go pray for someone. That's part of why we're here. You can go pray for somebody else. So if the Spirit is leading you, directing you to do that, I want to encourage you, do so this morning. So we're going to take a few moments and we're going to join together and pray through a time of worship. And then we'll close out together this morning.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. Lord turns his face toward you and give you peace. Lord, feet. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In the name I come alive to declare your victory. Resurrecting me, resurrecting me.
Stay beside us. You watch behind us. That God, you are in every area, every aspect of our lives. We just thank you for that reminder from your word this morning. Father, we thank you. You are gracious to us. Because God, there are certainly moments and times where, Lord, we don't deserve it, but out of your love for us, you're gracious and you're merciful to us. And we thank you for that this morning. Father, I pray this morning that you would help us to have wisdom, Lord, to identify maybe the unhealthy habits that maybe we have in our life right now. And to have the strength to change those habits that we have and replace them with new healthy habits, with habits, Lord, that are going to help lead us closer towards you, that are going to help us in fellowship and unity with brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, I pray you would just continue to surround us, God. You would continue to help us to have sweet times of fellowship. That you would help us, Lord, not just in our Sunday mornings and in our Wednesdays and our Thursdays, Lord, to have these gatherings and these times, Lord, where we meet and encourage and study and learn and lift one another up and pray for one another. But Lord, I pray that throughout our week, Lord, we would be intentional in having time. God, not only in our personal life, in prayer and in your word, but Lord, in fellowship with believers in Christ. So Father, I pray this morning that we would understand the importance of healthy habits, the importance of a healthy rhythm of life when it comes to walking in our faith. God, I pray that you would help us to all continue to understand and see not just the importance, but the necessity of truly belonging to a body of Christ. Father, I pray that as we go out now, God, you would just bless each and every person. I pray, God, that you would bring about divine appointments, Lord, where people would cross our path, or Lord, either you'll use us to speak life into their situation, or God, you may use them to speak life into the situations that we're walking through right now. Father, we just thank you that you are a Lord, God, who is in the midst of each and every detail of our lives. And may we never forget that. May we always remember, Lord, that you have care and concern for every aspect of our lives. We thank you this morning. We praise you. We ask now again, God, that you would cause your face to shine upon us, that you would be gracious to us, and that we would walk out now with the peace of the Lord in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of the sudden I am unaware of these afflictions, eclipsed by glory.